Outward Bound is one of the most unique experiences you can ever have.
Anakiwa is just full of spirit, wairua.
We used to say in the All Blacks, you join the most special club of all. And I think with the Outward Bound in New Zealand, if you've gone through a course there, then you're a special person.
Some gut feeling in me knew that I was going to be experiencing something quite profound.
You're detached from the rest of the world and you really get to be open and honest with everyone, and you have to trust them to get through some of the activities. If it wasn't for Outward Bound, I wouldn't be here today. I would have taken another handful of pills.
Some of the absolute highlights of my life, really and truly.
To go to a place that is devoid of all electronic stimulus, to be out in nature, to be under the stars, it doesn't happen anywhere else.
We were strangers, but by the time you leave, you develop comradeship, friendship, outward boundship.
I was identified as a future potential Olympian / world champion. Rowing for me isn't always easy, and it isn't always fun. And so for me, at 21, 22, I had to make the choice then whether I was going to really push on and have a really good go at it or sort of fade away.
I was 18 and I'd just started as a cadet with the New Zealand Customs Department. And as a person, I was a quiet, unassuming sort. Hadn't really sort of found my place in the world yet, and I knew that there was something else in me. I knew that there was something bigger.
A guy who wasn't quite sure where he wanted to go, what he wanted, not as fit. In fact, when I went down there, I would have been a couple of stone over my optimum weight.
I've been identified by a judge at the time who was a great supporter of Outward Bound and was just given the opportunity to get into some good stuff as opposed to getting distracted and getting into mischief, you know, drugs, alcohol, and just being a motley teenager. It was just like the unknown. Yes, there was some resistance. Yes, there was some angst, like I'm just so annoyed about this. But at the same time, there was that potentiality of, wow, what are we going to be doing for the next month?
I worked for the New Zealand Broadcasting Corporation. They felt that I had some sort of potential to become an administrator, which I never saw and still haven't. And I think they felt that by sending me to Outward Bound, it would give me a little bit more confidence, which I lacked. I was quite naive and very shy.
One challenge is somebody to come on up here and organise two songs.
Alrighty, now we've got some songs we're going to have.
We want to do it together, so just so we can practice it.
Tū tera mai nā iwi, owe, tato, tato, we. Tū tera mai nā iwi, owe, tato, tato, we. Mai ātu mana ki toka, me te aroha. E ngā iwi, ki ahutahi tahi, ki ahutahi rā. Tato, tato, we. Tato, tato.
Tahiru wa tore paku si au.
When you arrive at camp, and there's some people around thinking, oh gosh, they're a bit different, they won't be with me. And they start calling out your watches, the group you're going to be with. We were Rutherford. And they called me out, and then there was about 10 other guys, 11 other guys, maybe 9. And in the end, what they did was, I didn't have one person there really didn't have an interest the same.
Alfie Tate, David Bell, David Blathway, Emily Shanley, Georgia Belka.
It was a hell of a mixture, really. During those three and a half weeks, everything comes out.
That's very much like Everest. You know, quite often on our Everest expedition, half the members I didn't know, you know, and half I knew really well. And so once again, it's about bringing those diverse people together and being able to actually really mould and create a real team around that.
Mud as a metaphor, it's kind of like forming a bit of a mask right now. Is that fair enough? Sort of,
yeah.
Sort of, or hiding our true self. So this is a really good chance to wash that mask off and be who you want to be here.
Last year, he unfortunately died.
A great course for me will be maybe not catch a pig, but maybe like at least hit one or
My granddad said this really changed his life, so he wanted me to go on the Outward Bound, and so it changed my life too.
I took a few knocks last year, so I came this year to try and regain a lot of what I lost.
I believe in the balloon theory. Life's like a balloon, it keeps shrinking in on you unless you push at the boundaries, and this is one of my ways to push back at the boundaries.
I remember 50 years ago when Outward Bound started, I wanted to come. A great course for me would be that I regained my self-confidence that had been shaken with the onset of Parkinson's.
And I came here because it's the only place I know of where a 54-year-old can roll in the mud.
New Zealanders like to think of themselves as rugged he-men, who climb mountains and beat the world at rugby. The change to a modern society has not been all profit. Motorbikes and leather jackets, a modern form of toughness, but without the effort and adventure which builds character. The problem of directing the energy of young men into the right channels exercised the mind of Lord Cobham during his period as Governor General.
It was to satisfy that need that Kurt Hahn and the founders of the Outward Bound movement started this great adventure.
With such encouragement, a committee was formed and sufficient money raised to buy a 26-acre property at Anakiwa in the Marlborough Sounds, the Governor General himself declaring it open in 1962. Alongside the sea set in rugged bush country, the Outward Bound school has been described as the best in the world.
We're fondly referred to as the 69ers. I recall getting the letter from Outward Bound saying, you need to have some quality leather boots, which you will soak in water with your feet in them and then run the streets in them and then cover them with dubbin, which I did. Thankfully I did, but I couldn't believe what I was doing. I was standing in the bath with these leather boots on. I looked at the photo of myself not long ago and I had creases in my shorts. I think my mother must have ironed them before I went away.
The 23-day course involves boating, bushcraft, canoeing, rock climbing and service work, and developing self-confidence and skills through practical team activities.
in the 50 years that it's been in New Zealand. It started off as boys only, men only, and I think it was just one basic course, and now the types of courses that you can do, I mean, there's the ones that I've done, which is the classic, which is your 21 days, and then there's also a discovery, which is about an 8-day one, and there's the leaps and bounds, which is for parents and their children. There's the special needs, there's groups that deal with corporate business and working together in that way. They're catering to all walks of life.
Put the arms and go! Keep it going! 3, 4, 5, 16, 17. Left, right, left.
Month in a day. You are so active, you know, you're getting up, you're doing these calisthenics in the dark and the rain, you finish half an hour of those, you go for a run, you jump in the ocean, and then it's time for breakfast.
I remember thinking, this is just like the army. It's regimented, the instructors are tough, you don't mess with them, and I thought, you know, why have I chosen to come here?
All these people say, it's a fantastic experience, you're gonna have the time of your life, and well, that was just crap. That first week, 10 days, I was having a tough time. I knew I was strapped in. I knew I was totally safe. My head was saying, this is a piece of cake. My body was screamingly uncomfortable.
Can't get out of the little rock
back off. That's it. That's it. I think that's as far as I can go.
All right,
it's fine.
Yeah, on the left. Try the left, Georgia.
That's as far as I can go.
Try the left.
Cross, there's a bit of a crevice in there.
That's right?
Yeah, a little bit. Yeah.
Commit to it. You can do it.
Okay, good job. Yeah! Nice climbing!
I couldn't fit in mine, it'd been so big. I went to go to the shed and pull out this great extra big kayak without the splash guards, and it was a little harder to balance, and so I had this great big one and I had to use that all the time. And I was hopeless at kayaking.
Nathan, that's a flathead for you. Talking about the comfort zone and getting out of that comfort zone, this is your chance.
You got me.
I was diagnosed with brain tumour when I was 14. I became legally blind, and there's nothing like not being able to see a rapid and then falling over and tipping and getting back up. Brilliant experience.
When I was travelling overseas with my first husband, we were in a canyoning accident, and it was a whitewater. A flood, flash flood came down, and I lost him and all my friends I was travelling with. I got down to the water, got suited up, got on the kayak, and started having these horrific flashbacks. And The leader pulled me aside and asked me what was going on, and I told her, and she took me away from the group, talked to the group, and collectively all those people came to me and said, we're pulling out, we've been looking forward to this for the whole 3 weeks, but you're more important. I was just amazed at the empathy and the compassion that those people had around me that I'd only known for a few weeks.
Are you ready to tack? Tacking!
What a rough sea.
I had one of those dark moments on the course growing up as a kid. I never ever thought that I'd go sailing. It just wasn't in my world. To be out in this cutter cruising around the Queen Charlotte Sound and catching the wind was just awesome. We'd been going all day, and it was about 5 o'clock when we got there, and we were thinking, sweet, this is going to be getting into our bed soon, make some kayak. And then they said, oh no, now you've got to go right across the other side of the sound. And I was like, no, you can't do this to us, eh?
You know, us all being rowers and thinking we're, you know, pretty hot stuff just after getting back from under 23 world champs, go, right, this should be a walk in the park. And for me, I'm normally rowing in a single, so I'm not used to working as a team, and there's quite a few guys that are like that, you know, we're all quite individual at this stage, and we didn't even make it halfway.
How long do you think we've been on for now? Non-stop.
2 hours?
2.5?
Come on.
Coming into that bit, we think.
Yeah.
Maybe we're lying.
Where's the bay?
Oh, yeah, there's the bay we're going into. So we've come through here. That's the length of there. So we're somewhere in here, I think.
And I remember just laying down on my back and looking up at the mast and the little lights we had on top of it and just all the stars and that just, it was just magic.
Following the cutter is always a launch, which is a safety launch, and the launch has a roof which is probably 3 meters above the water. Matt has a phobia, not of swimming, but of jumping into frigid cold water. And so I treaded water and encouraged him, and it took him 5, 7, 8, maybe 10 minutes. And good on him, he did it. But I can certainly remember what it was like to tread water in 10 degrees with a smile on my face, encouraging Matt.
1, 2, 3, 4.
Struggle. Can you save me?
Outward bound, I really want to work on my people skills and hopefully become a really good father one day.
I'm a stormman in Auckland, come from a big family. What I want from outbound is to give me that confidence and hopefully lose some weight as well, because pretty big.
Not really sure what I want to gain from outward bound just yet. Maybe a bit of self-esteem. Stop smoking. When I found out how intense it was, I stopped.
How's that going for you?
Lovely.
Grew up in South Auckland and was a pretty good young soul, I guess, when I was younger, and good parents, good family, loved them all. And then got a skateboard, done all the stuff that you do when you're young and dumb and full of something. And a bit of trouble.
When you're up against it constantly, physically, mentally, emotionally. You're exhausted. You're sleeping with, you know, in bunks next to people snoring. You can't get sleep. It pushes you to a point that at some stage you'll break and you'll open up. And if you don't open up, then it's to your detriment.
When you remove all the distractions and all the stuff that's happening in your head and out there, to pare it back, get back to nature, get back to real, and almost get back to the real you.
And I was marking down, you know, Roman figures, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, cross out. And I was going 25 days to go, 24, 23. It was tough. It was, but I wasn't going to stop. And then halfway through, I stopped doing that.
Day 5, I've got blisters. Already we're making jokes and teasing each other, but it's all in good sense of humour and nobody's had a fallout. Mornings certainly aren't getting any easier. The car's just burnt today. We keep track of our times, and since day one I haven't been able to beat it yet. Yeah, right now we're camped at Bio River. Evan's making nachos for dinner.
Boy.
Yeah, I'd love to.
I was nervous today because we've just been on the outward bound cutter. Tomorrow they're expecting like 50 knots or something. Day 9, we're all happy because we're having a service day tomorrow, which it's helping out around outward bound and around Anakiwa.
We made a cheer.
And Shanti.
Hi, thank you so much.
Yeah.
Hello.
Chaz,
is there a cup up here somewhere?
I've met the coolest people in the world right here in my watch. And I hope to keep contact with them for the rest of my life.
Whoa! Just get into it.
This is day 10. I was really pleased with my PT run this morning. I was able to beat my personal best. We're on kitchen duty. It's going to be real hard saying goodbye to everyone.
Even if you do go through a life-threatening illness, you continue to learn about yourself. Only so much you can push yourself in a situation in the outdoors.
Everyone had different strengths and weaknesses, but we were taught to do everything as a group.
There are going to be some times when I'm not going to be able to do things, and that's okay. And I'm okay with that. It doesn't mean that I'm a lesser person because of it. Which I think in the past, you know, was part of one of the thoughts that cropped into my mind.
So 100k wind, do you reckon, Darren? Zip your jacket up. Alright, wait. Can you pass?
It's the same track, hey? We went past yesterday.
Is it?
You know that one that we caught on to when we ended up going up to Duke's Head?
So we're here
so
now.
So we're there, so we'll end up coming down this ridge and connecting onto the track there.
We're going to head down on a 65 degree bearing, and we're going to eventually end up at a marked track,
so we just need to keep following this ridge down. So everyone put their compass on 65.
So bearing 65?
Yeah.
Did you hear what they said, the track was?
No, I have no idea. I didn't see a track.
Getting hustled.
How far back did you see the track?
All the way up the hill.
Almost at the top.
It's
we should be on 720. That's where the track meets the ridge.
You need to find the track. The easiest way is to go uphill and find it.
What's wrong with just keep going down?
It's just so horrifically steep. Like, it's easier to go up that than go down. Stuff that's like cliffs.
Let's go, team. I want to get out before we go. Thank you. Let's go.
Well, how does a team get up a hill?
Together.
Yeah, you push, you get behind, you push somebody.
Good stuff, I think.
Go straight up that ridge.
How come we didn't see it then?
Where is this track?
I know we're getting closer.
Yay, track. It's like a lifeline.
We just decided, hey, you know, cool, we've achieved a big thing up here, and let's just take a photo in our undergarments. Hey, you're up, I think it might be 1,200, 1,300 metres above sea level, and you're just like, yeah, and I will probably never come back to this spot again. We just came out of 3 days of like hiking up to Mount Royal. We thought we were going back to the lodge to have a shower, da 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 da. But she just, you know, left us, started dropping us off along the way. And so for me, I really, that was actually my favourite part of Outward Bound, is the solo.
Solo. We're out there for 72 hours. That was the one scheme I was most afraid about.
Take you at night time. And so we're all in there nervous together, and you go by boat, and all of a sudden they stop at the first sight and they call out someone's name. The big spotlight comes on and the little boat takes you to shore, and they spotlight all the way up to wherever there's a little, you know, area of like 4x4 meters or 5x5, which is a flat land or something like that. And it wasn't raining, it was very windy at this stage. And they said, that's your posse, you're right. I said, yeah, yeah. And the spotlight goes off.
I'm not fond of rats. To see, I think there were three or four just scurrying around the area where the spotlight was being shone, where the little flat ledge was on which I would place my tent.
I did my exercises and weights, and I was next to the riverbed and made sure I did weights and stuff. But then there was a lot of writing. I did a lot of writing.
Write down what was important, important to you, and also what your values were. And for me, it was the first time that I'd actually taken the time to consider such important aspects of your life.
I think I wrote about 48 pages of journal. It was just stuff coming out.
I carved my initials, and it took hours of delicate carving and numerous shells And that's what I did. JMCBETH is carved somewhere in the Marlborough Sounds.
They give you a pen and paper and they said write poems or write some letters or something. I just drew. I didn't really do that at all. I made some paper planes and threw them around the place. It was very, very tough.
We've had to set up our fly tent in the dark. It's a nice time to just think we've all, 14 people have been living pretty much on top of each other for the last week or so, so a bit of peace really do us all some good, I think. We're starting to get a bit edgy at each other. Today is just thinking about where I want to head in life. I know I want to be in the outdoors, but I don't know where to go or what to do in the outdoors. So today that question has just been going round and round in my head. Three apples, three carrots, three flapjacks, and a bag of scrotum. I've been writing letters and then also just writing in my journal to keep up to date with it. Just the things that pop into your head sometimes really amazes you how deep your mind can think. It does get quite scary when you go into big, deep thoughts.
I never have nothing going on, and I'm thinking, how am I going to survive this? And I remember the second I got dropped off, and it was just suddenly like a weight off my shoulders. I thought, this is remarkable. It is so peaceful. I actually have nobody pushing me to do anything.
Just the wind, the silence, the waves.
I didn't want to speak after we got off solo. I just wanted to keep silent, and then people were itching to speak, but I just wouldn't speak until we got back to Anakiwa and sat down and had our debrief, and that was the first words I spoke.
It's raining and you're wet and you've packed up all your stuff and you're carrying all your stuff and you're carrying your bucket of excrement as well. And you're freezing, you can't ask for help, and I wouldn't anyway, but I went up in the air, my bucket went up in the air and I came down and my bucket came down all over me. And I'm lying in the mud and I'm cold and I'm hurt and I'm covered in my own shit. And I'm thinking, you know what, it's only up from here.
The mic's going to definitely peel the lid off this bucket. And pour the concrete through here for later for the boat on.
Three nights, 2.5 days without a shower.
Oh, this is just good. Just a non-wet sleep. Yeah. Yes. Good. Come on.
How long do you guys need until sleeping bags are hung up and you guys are ready for lunch?
Should we get to dry stuff?
Oh.
On the outside line?
Nah. And a proper dry?
Put them outside and we'll see how they go.
I had a bit of time on solo, thinking who I am and what mask am I wearing, etc. And then I thought from solo I'll start afresh, start who I want to be. So it was about 13 years, I hadn't had a shave after doing solo. I got everyone from the course to come in and cut a piece of my beard off. Then I trimmed it all off and had a shave and then kind of freaked myself out.
I drew a picture. I drew Cutter, and like a crack when Tristan left, another one when Lee left, and then I did like high reps core, solo and kayaking and stuff.
Yeah, that's my stick. And I thought, yeah, we could kind of share it.
I was just spelling out Cobham. C for courageous, O for outrageous, B for bravery. If you don't want to get fat, then don't eat savories. Yeah. H for humble, don't mess with the Cobham boys, because we'll make you crumble. Yeah, yeah. A for achieve, M for manpower, because we stand tall and strong like the Sky Tower. Yeah, that's pretty much it.
I attended Lap with Baum when I was 25 years old, and it was a few months after I'd taken an overdose. I didn't feel I had a purpose due to severe depression, and that was from a sexual assault. My group was absolutely wonderful, the most amazing people, and it just wasn't even an issue. You wrote comments about your group members, and you sat in a circle and everyone read out your comments about you, and it was amazing, though, reading out these comments, and it was the person I knew before I was sick. I still cry when I read them now.
You know, a couple of people said to me, you know, that I need to, they want to be closer friends with me, but I don't let them in, I suppose. You know, that's going back to the whole trust thing and how I was very fiercely independent. You know, I know what I want and I'll go out and get it, and everyone else stand aside.
Atwood Brown decided to leave me with one more challenge to go home with, the only challenge I can't get over. Smoking, I couldn't give it up. I had been warned previously because I had been caught before. I still chose not to listen. On my solo, we're meant to be in this, you know, state by ourselves. We're meant to, you know, try and get to know ourselves better, and we have certain rules that you're not meant to break. And I was like, wow, what perfect timing. I can actually sit out here by myself and have a ciggy that I've been dying for. I'm so lucky, you know, like, who else is getting this on their cell? You know, I'm like, yay! I get back the next day. Michelle comes to pick me up, and I hadn't even looked at my task, and I had done nothing. I was begging them to keep me there. I was like, come on, it's 3 days. And she just said, no, that is the rules. And rules are there for a reason, and I've always been good at breaking rules. Can bend rules, you know, there's always a way around it, you know, there's just always a way. No, there isn't. You stick to the rules and you'll always be good. So I missed out, and like I'm missing out now, I have to go home and I don't get to see the end result. It sucks.
I think it took several hours. I stopped several times. But the point is that I did the marathon.
I didn't worry about a time. It was not to stop. And through those Ks, and I achieved it. And I was so stoked with myself. I was so stoked that I did that.
I had this time where I just stopped because I realised two things, that the marathon was, you know, I had achieved the goal, but a day after, I'd be going home.
My mother said, you've changed. My brother said, you've changed. My father said, you've changed. My friends said, I've changed. Physically, I'd changed. Yes, I'd come back a stone and a half, 2 stone lighter, fitter. but I'd change as a person. 6 months after that, all of a sudden I was an All Black. I wouldn't have been an All Black at that time if it wasn't for Outward Bound. It showed me things that I didn't know I had. It was a mental thing more than anything else, if you like, the psychological scenario of you don't know what you can't do.
Within a year, I had left customs, left my secure, safe New Zealand customs job for a freelance professional dance career. I mean, how opposite is that?
Miss Universe New Zealand 1985, and she is. From Auckland, 21 years of age, Claire Glenister.
Outward Bound gave me the courage and the confidence to make that leap of faith. And let me tell you, that leap of faith really kick-started my my life in my 20s.
Well, you know, you did a course at Outward Bound School. That's supposed to prepare you for anything. Did it prepare you for this?
Well, actually, it was a very stressful course, and I didn't enjoy it while I was there, but we're not meant to enjoy it while we're there. But I think I've benefited from going anyway.
When I found my desire to be an actor, it was a terrifying moment.
You'll get him, okay?
Taking that plunge to step way out of my comfort zone and go, how the hell am I going to start this journey? It was exactly the same thing as Outward Bound, of getting your plot points and going, I have no idea how we're going to get from there to there in 3 days.
My goals that I set down were to run a marathon, and at that point I was always very sporty as a kid and an adult as well, but I hadn't done any endurance events, so to do a marathon I had no idea how I was going to do it, but I thought I'd put down something crazy. As it turns out, I've gone on and done more crazy things. This year I have qualified for the World Championships in Las Vegas for the long distance triathlon. I'll be wearing the silver fern for my age group, which is very exciting. Outward Bound turned my life around. It helped me realise who I was as a person and the type of life I wanted to live.
When we came back from the course, Craig and I started thinking, well, we need to do something for our own. We can incorporate what Outward Bound have, but we can bring in our kaitahu taka with Aoraki Bound. We spend 8 to 10 days up at Anakiwa, and then we go on our hikoi. So a lot of people come on the course, they're just thirsty for knowledge, you know, on their whakapapa or history of the South Island. Whose footsteps are they travelling in? You know, Rākai Hotu, how did he name the lakes? Ponamu story, how did the Ponamu get to the South Island?
By the last night when they're up at Lake Pukaki and they're looking at Aoraki, you can see it all over their faces. They just know what they've done.
I threw out everything I knew and started from scratch, because what I was doing wasn't going to get me to the Olympics. To have the confidence to do that, it wasn't easy at all, and I had a lot of support, but some of the skills that I gained at Outward Bound definitely helped. To find yourself, I suppose, about Outward Bound, because you're put in situations you're not normally put in, and you start getting a sense of who you are and what drives you as a person. I moved into the double. It took a while for that concept to come together for me, because I've been so fiercely independent up until that stage. My goals now are to win Olympic gold at the 2012 Olympics, and then the year after that to graduate with an MBA from Oxford. Things have changed for me hugely in the last 4 years. I never thought that I'd be sitting in this position telling you these are my goals now. It's still scary just, you know, talking about them.
It doesn't actually matter whether I've worked with youth development, women's rights issues, education, whānau with unemployment, and families with disabilities. The common strand theme through those employment opportunities or kaupapa opportunities is service to others. And that's actually a key principle that comes out of Outward Bound.
So on my course, they said, all right, everyone's going to, you have to choose a name and say why it is special for you. And the name I chose was Te Kaio. 2 years later, when I had my first son, his name is Te Kaio. So I have that relationship between Outward Bound and him, because he carries that name.